Good afternoon, everyone. I'm excited to be here today. We're going to be talking about homeowners associations, but before we get started, I do need to make a couple of disclaimers. This presentation is intended to serve as legal information and does not replace legal advice. Contact Lone Star Legal Aid at 1-800-733-8394 or go to our website at www.lonestarlegal.org. for more information on legal assistance. Lone Star Legal Aid does not discriminate on the basis of race, color, religion, gender, gender expression, sexual orientation, age, national origin, ancestry, disability, marital status, or military status in any of its activities or operations. So now, just to introduce myself, my name is Caitlin Corey. I'm a staff attorney with Lone Star Legal Aid in their foreclosure prevention project. And Mario is also here with me today. He's going to speak a little bit later in the presentation. And we'll just go ahead and get started on talking about homeowners associations. Next slide, please. Oh, there's the disclaimer. Now, homeowners association can be a confusing topic with lots of complicated terms that can make it hard for buyers and homeowners to understand the requirements of purchasing a property with a homeowners association. So we're going to start at the beginning. Next slide, please. So there's a lot of different acronyms that you hear when you talk about this topic. A POA is considered a property owners association, and it consists of two different kinds of associations. The homeowners association, which is generally for detached single family homes, and a condo owners association. Both types of associations are considered nonprofit corporations, which in theory should govern themselves. We will discuss later some of the common issues that people have in dealing with their HOAs. Next slide, please. In order to create a property owners association, there are many governing documents that must be drafted and filed for them to have legal authority. This includes articles of incorporation, bylaws, rules and regulations, and something called a declaration of covenants, conditions, and restrictions. We'll go into more detail about those in just a minute. So who controls the board? The homeowners association, it's the board of directors. At the very beginning of the association, normally the developer will appoint who's a part of the board, as there aren't community members living there. And then later on, when there are people moving into the property, they have elections, and how those elections are run are described in the articles of incorporation. Next slide, please. Now, the Declaration of Covenants, Conditions, and Restricted Restrictions is a complicated name for essentially something that's a contract. This contract is generally created by the developer and filed in the county clerk deed records. And this will apply to any buyer of the community, whether at that time or later. The declaration will list special conditions or limits of what a buyer can use the property for. The conditions can create maintenance requirements for each owner, which can involve the appearance of the property. It can limit the use of the property, such as using it as an Airbnb, what color you paint your house, and even lawn maintenance. Next slide, please. The bylaws of an HOA gives the board rules for how they have to conduct business. I mentioned it can also include the election process of the board members, also, when maintenance and repairs to common areas are done and how it's being done, who is hired. If your HOA has a website, the bylaws and other governing documents may be available for you to review there. Next slide, please. Now, in addition to the declaration and bylaws, HOAs often create additional rules and regulations. This can be the use of the common areas, like a meeting room or a pool. And the purpose of these rules and regulations is, in theory, supposed to ensure each resident can enjoy their home and the common areas. But as I mentioned, we'll discuss some of the common problems that come up. Next slide, please. So one of the most important things is to review the governing documents before or if you've already purchased a property with an association. It's important to send a request in writing for information and keep this a copy of that writing for your records. You can look for a website, and records should be made available for inspection. They shouldn't charge you any money for that inspection. Next slide, please. Here's an example of an HOA with a website. Here you can clearly see how the governing documents are organized and made available easily for all of the residents in the community. Next slide, please. You can also find out information about an HOA by locating their management certificate. You can find this on a government website that we have posted on the slide. And this is an official website, so there's nothing to worry about. It's credible information. And keep in mind, this is only for homeowners associations. Condo owners associations may not have their management certificate on file at this website. Next slide, please. So here's the search page, which shows the kind of information that you'll need if you're trying to find your owner's association management certificate. Next slide, please. Now, we initially asked about who runs the homeowners association. Now, who is the board? Unlike what this photo may suggest, the board are typically not property management professionals, and they are usually volunteers. Next slide, please. So as I mentioned, they're usually volunteers. They live in your same community. So it's important that when you're trying to resolve any disputes, that you work to resolve it in a manner that is peaceful and can resolve other issues rather than escalate arguments between community members. Next slide. Now, at the very least, a Property Owners Association board has to have an annual meeting. However, it is very often that they hold many more meetings and take other action, but it does have to comply with Texas state law and the governing documents of the association. Next slide. Now, as I mentioned, the board typically don't know how to manage a community property. So they often hire a property management company. They usually help with maintaining records, collecting fees, and are the go-to contact that many residents have for the board. Now, this topic is increasingly important because more and more of the homes that are created or developed have some type of owner's association. So more than likely at some point in your life, you're going to run into an issue whether or not you live in this community or someone you know. Next slide, please. And now we'll talk about some of the common issues that owners and homeowners encounter when dealing with their association. Next slide, please. Some of the common issues in dealing with an HOA is board mismanagement and the property management company. Also, how past due payments are collected, and even when HOAs will offer unreasonable payment plans that an owner simply cannot afford for HOA fees that aren't paid. Next slide, please. What makes these practices even more harmful is that an HOA board often turns over fees and fines that are delinquent to a law firm that they have retained. Once a law firm starts pursuing collections, the cost will increase dramatically, even from something as simple as sending a letter all the way through filing a lawsuit. Next slide, please. As I mentioned, even small disputes can easily escalate and cause other problems, especially if the HOA board is mismanaged. While it's natural to react strongly, it's important to make these complaints and violations known in a manner that will help resolve it. It's also a good practice to maintain documentation of this communication. So if you can, try to communicate via email. Next slide. Probably the most common reason someone seeks legal help against a property owner's association is because they're behind on their assessment fees. Now, first, what is an assessment fee? It's a fee charged against the homeowners for the continued maintenance of the community. The frequency of assessments is determined in the governing documents. Typically, a homeowners association will have an annual assessment fee, and it's more common for condo owners association to have monthly assessment fees. Also, keep in mind that in addition to the regular assessments, HOAs and condo owners associations have the authority to issue a special assessment for a particular repair issue. This could be something like the foundation needs to be repaired or other significant repair issues that will significantly cost more money to repair. The process by which they can do these special assessments is set out by their governing documents. Next slide. So now that we've briefly talked about homeowners associations and the problems that people encounter, we're also going to talk about how property owners associations can lead to foreclosure and evictions. Many times people are surprised that an HOA has the authority to foreclose on their property. Next slide. Now, Aline, what gives the HOA the power to foreclose is a lien on the piece of property. This lien is essentially used as collateral for a loan or other financial obligation. This lien is what gives the property owners association the authority to foreclose. Next step. Now, Texas is a non-judicial state, which means a home can be foreclosed on without a lawsuit in certain situations. These situations include when you're behind on your mortgage, they can foreclose without a lawsuit. But keep in mind that a foreclosure auction can only take place on the first Tuesday of each month here in Texas. Now, if the first Tuesday falls on a holiday like this year with July 4th, the foreclosure auction will happen on the next business day. Next slide, please. Now, turning to foreclosures for HOAs, the two different categories of property owners association have two different methods of foreclosure. Keep in mind that HOAs can only foreclose if you owe maintenance assessments. Next slide. An HOA cannot foreclose if they find you for certain things, like painting your house a non-approved color, needing to collect your trash bins, other items that they state are violations of the governing documents. It can only be the assessment or special assessment fees delinquency that can give them the right to foreclose. Next slide. Now, I mentioned a homeowners association and the condo owners association foreclose different ways. A homeowners association must send a pre-collection letter informing of how much is owed and gives them 45 days to become current on their assessments. An HOA must file a lawsuit in order to foreclose. Once you are served, an owner generally has 20 days to file an answer once you're served with notice of the lawsuit. If you don't file an answer, they can proceed and request a judgment on default because you did not provide the answer or appear at the hearing. An HOA cannot foreclose on your property until the judge signs the order giving the HOA the right to put the property up for foreclosure sale at the next auction. Unlike homeowners association, a condo owners association can follow the same non-judicial foreclosure process like a mortgage company. They only need to send two letters via certified mail. The first is a demand for payment and giving you time to be brought current. Then the second one is the notice of foreclosure sale. This notice has to include the details of the sale of the condo for auction. It's extremely rare for a condo association to be required to file a lawsuit. Next slide. Now, if a judgment has entered and the foreclosure has been scheduled and the auction has occurred, that does not mean the new owner can just come into the house and tell you to leave. They have to follow the same legal eviction process to get possession of the home. So the first step they have to take is to send a 3-day notice to vacate via certified mail. If the former owner has not left by then they must proceed with the eviction lawsuit in the Justice of the Peace Court in which the property is located. After filing the lawsuit, the former owner must be served notice, which requires the constable serve the lawsuit. However, the constable can get permission to drop off the mail or paperwork in certain situations. If the former owner does not appear at the eviction trial, then the new owner can get a judgment by default. And both parties have the right to appeal this judgment within 10 days of the judge signing the order. Keep in mind, being evicted from the property does not impact your right to redeem. There are certain situations, but the earlier that you reach out for help and get assistance, as soon as you know your property is at risk of foreclosure, the more options that you have. Now we're going to turn to the next topic about a unique program that started during COVID. Mario, who's also with our unit, is going to present that information.
Good afternoon, everyone. As Ms. Kaylin Corey has dictated, I will be presenting some facts about the Texas Homeowner Assistance Program that's been designed in response to the COVID-19 pandemic. As we all know, a lot of homeowners have trouble trying to keep up with payments related to their home, whether it be home mortgages, property taxes, or in this case, HOA fees. This program has been designed to offer some kind of relief for the homeowner, so they'll be able to, you know, compose themselves and keep up with their payments. So, here's a quick introduction to the Texas Homeowners Assistance Fund. Purpose is to provide financial assistance to qualified Texas homeowners who have fallen behind on their mortgages and related expenses due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Grants may cover mortgage payments and property taxes, insurance, and other HO fees. I kind of skipped myself there for a moment, but one thing we would like to remind you is that this is not a loan. This is not a payment type of program. You do not have to pay anything. This is money that's been given out for assistance by the government as a way of keeping up with their payments. Now, many of them are kind of puzzled as to what's coming from, but this is a package that's been approved by the government from the Biden administration in order to assist homeowners. So that's the thing we like to cover. Same thing, financial assistance. So here's a sort of a rundown of the Texas Homeowner Assistance website, same thing. This program is also not only giving them assistance for mortgage payments, but can cover up to 3 months of future payments, cover property taxes, property insurance, HOA fees, condo fees, and as well as including utility payments. So that includes electricity, natural gas, propane, water, and wastewater. So a little bit about the program. This program started back in March of 2022. And of course, like any other government funded programs, the homeowners must meet income eligibility requirements, which we'll go over pretty shortly. Okay, so here are the criteria that the homeowners must qualify under. First, they must experience any financial hardship after January 21st, 2020. That's when the pandemic came in full effect. Loss of job, cut in hours, perhaps a family gotten sick, or even the same, something as inequitable as small as buying a mask could be qualified as a type of financial hardship, or rather something experienced through the pandemic. And of course, this program only helps out with homeowners who are, you know, behind on their mortgages, property taxes, HOA fees, and other type of utilities related to their home. This program was designed in order to prevent the homeowner from losing their home to any type of foreclosure, as Ms. Kaylin has described earlier regarding the HOAs, not just HOAs, but the county can foreclose on you if you're behind your property taxes. And of course, the lenders or mortgage companies can also do that if you aren't able to keep up with the payments. Third criteria is that the household income be at or below 100% area median income or 100% of the median income of the United States, whichever is greater. So we'll go over the numbers as to what that means for a typical household of four people, but we can start as low as one and go all the way up. Typically, they're about the same, but depending on the number of people and how much income is getting, they have to have some sort of meta criteria in order to qualify. And of course, always is important that they own and occupy a home in Texas, a primary residence. So if you do have a property that you're paying behind on, if you're not living in there, that's probably will disqualify you for any assistance. You know, this is designed to keep people in their homes, not keep people hang on to their assets. So here's some more tidbits of the what the program consists of. So each homeowner is qualified up to $65,000 in mortgage assistance, HOA, property tax assistance. That's a combination, although there's still some tabs to keep up. There's also $65,000 is the maximum that one can qualify for mortgage assistance, with $25,000 can be used as a cap for other, there was a $25,000 cap for costs related to HOAs, property taxes, property insurance, but that has been rescinded. And now any or old cap can be gone together and be added. So if a homeowner has a combination, if the amount doesn't not exceed $65,000, they can qualify for all assistance. Although there is a cap for $10,000 for utility assistance, and that is non-negotiable, but most homeowners meet that criteria. And as always, homeowners can apply online, or they can call the number below. There are the numbers in there. And then of course, there's the website. That's the only way you can be able to apply to. They'll create a portal online, or if you have require any assistance with this type of application, the number will assist them in submitting one for them. So here are the type of programs that the Texas half is compromised of. Mortgage program, as we discuss, the amount that there's given out is to sort of either keep the homeowner mortgage reinstated, keep up with their payments to get it back at zero. And of course, if there's they need more required assistance, then they can get up 3 months of future payments in order to keep up and give them some sort of relief, so they'll be ready to pay when it's their turn. Now, that's still under the $65,000 limit. So if the homeowner's limit will not allow them to get further assistance, then that is as much as they can give them as the Texas Homeowner Assistance Fund. Funds have actually been designed to sort of give everybody, homeowners various across the state, some sort of relief. And of course, make sure that everybody who has a need assistance can get it, and sort of make sure that's more than enough to go around. Of course, property charges are also now under this type of a cap. Same thing, property taxes, HOA fees, anything of that sort will have to be under be used at $65,000 limit. That used to be $25,000, but that type of restriction has been removed. So now, they can go ahead and use them. Although there is another added restriction with that, whether that the property taxes and any of the payments must not exceed before 2016. So any payments that exceed that will not be covered. But sometimes most homeowners, their type of assistance will typically start by around that date. So there should be no assistance, although it had to be with an extreme. There have been homeowners who have about a decade of past due, and this sort of cases, even if they don't are still under the cap, the Texas half won't be able to cover all that. Then the objective is to keep the homeowner caught up, as to give them enough funding so they can start their life anew. And again, utilities, same thing. Although the cap of $10,000 is still there, and that can be a combination of any of our utility services that they might be submitted to: electric, gas, water, wastewater, any of that. So typically that's how the application step process works. There's a pre-eligibility check. When the homeowner starts their application, they'll be asking to get a number of questions: how many in their household, what's the income for each, what's the request, and what is their hardship, what's the type of amount that they need. And of course, they will be also asking for any documentation that supports this, some mortgage statements, property tax statements, HOA statements. So that can be all obtained and submitted along with any other documents to support their requests. And of course, the Texas HOA will be requiring identification for all household members, any type of pay slips or pay stubs or income proof. In lieu of that, there are some forms that the homeowner can fill out called the attestation that'll basically declare how much income the house is getting, how much they're behind on their mortgage or property taxes or anything of that sort. And of course, the declaration that says that they attested all this to being true. So once a homeowner completes that criteria, fills out the applications and submits it, a review process will begin. First off, an auditor will be assigned to the application, and the auditor will make sure that all documents are up to date within 45 days of the submission. And of course, make sure that the documents are eligible to read and clear, as well as that the whole eligibility is met. Of course, that's step four when they review everything. And of course, step five when they confirm with the opposing side, in this case, mortgage companies, the county for any type of property taxes, the HOA. Sometimes they'll have to talk to the HOA attorneys if there is such a thing involved, in order to make sure that the payment that the homeowner's requested is solid and true, and of course applied. They will ask them if the Texas HOA does indeed pay off, will the homeowner be at a good standing after the payment is issued. So once all that's been covered and good, the step six begins, where the final eligibility review begins. And of course, that's when it leads into hopefully step seven, where payment is released. And of course, that should settle all the debts by the homeowner. So going back to that area median income. So as you see here, we have some of the several counties within Southeast Texas: Brazoria, Chambers, Galveston, Hardin, Harris, Jefferson, Liberty, Matagorda, Orange, and Wharton, just to give you an idea. Typically, most of these counties under a household of two will, maybe even up to a household of three, will fit it within the $9,000 income limit. Household of four, two as well. Although once you get to the household of five, that you'll see some disparities. Keep in mind that while most Texas homeowners who experience kind of hardship do qualify, that any more will lose eligibility, and that also counts up income from everybody in the household, not just the main breadwinner. So this is the current numbers as of August 21st as to what Texas has given out and has approved and what it has. So as of this date, and the numbers might be a bit different from what I've been from what I'm about to show you, they have given out over $500 million in assistance, with an additional 25,000 ready to go. $2,500,000 ready to go. So as you can see, that the program's initial funding was about 700,000. So while those numbers are very near up, we're still recommending the homeowners to apply, since we have not yet heard any news whether the program is ready to be closed or not. So we can see here 48,000 homeowners in the state of Texas have been helped alone, average assistance 11,000, and of course 600 are coming on the way. So as you can see, this type of assistance has been greatly impacted a lot of homeowners in the state of Texas, with the most of the majority given to mortgage assistance, as you can probably see. Although I'm afraid that you can't see the other ones, but the amount that the mortgage assistance have been approved for towards the rest of the others: property taxes, HOAs, insurance requests, and of course utilities. So here's in Harris County alone, as you can see more clearly how much the one of the biggest counties in Texas has been largely impacted by this. And I'm going to show you some other counties as well. Well, not exactly, I apologize. So, you know, here are some more highlights as to how much payment has been paid, and how much, you know, the money has been assisting these households, and how much of these assistance has been going to. As you can see, mortgages, property taxes are going neck and neck, HOA fees next, barbecue is a little later, but utilities are also giving a fair share amount. And that was pretty much my section of Texas Have. Thank you for your attention, and we'll be fielding any questions if anybody has any.
Yes, thank you, Mario. And as he mentioned, the assistance is going by fast. There's no date of when the portal is going to close, but apply as soon as you can. And it doesn't look like there's any other questions, but thank you for listening. And please, if you need legal advice, contact an attorney, or you can apply for our services by contacting the number or going online and making an application. Thank you again. Bye-bye.